Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome. Feel free to stand or sit, whatever feels best for your heart and your body.
Turn our eyes from the painful things. Oh, For us to study it, to go through it, to kind of chew on it, if you will, and what it means for us. So we get to do that this morning with such a special and amazing event in John chapter 20 here that we get to do that. We're so thankful for your word that we can know what believing in you, Jesus, means. So we can know what the resurrection means to us too. So it's in your name, Jesus, we pray these things. And everybody said, amen. Amen. John chapter 20, verse 1 says, now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. There was a television show that I used to watch when I was growing up. Some of you may remember it. Some of you may remember the newspaper panels or sections. It was called Ripley's Believe It or Not, right? It was a very interesting show because it would run through those weird or those unusual events, those stories that would take place in our world. Odd facts and items, these oddities around the world, people, places, bizarre events. And it first began as a panel in the newspaper and would later make its way to other formats such as radio, such as television, and even a chain of museums. And this bizarre entertainment was founded by Leroy Robert Ripley, who had a special affinity to the strange and the unusual oddities of this world. Some so strange that the readers would question the claims. People had to decide if these strange and unusual accounts were true or made up.
Sorry.
You're okay. People had to make the choice to believe it or not. Our gospel writer, John, here gives us an event that you could also label as strange or unusual. But his intent, even his heart behind writing this account, behind this event, is so that we would believe, so that we would have life in Jesus' name. That was John's whole purpose of writing this gospel. Believe that Jesus lived, that he is who he said he was. Believe that Jesus did not accomplish all that he said he was going to do, and that Jesus died on the cross to save us from the wrath of God. But also believe that Jesus is alive, that he is risen, and by his resurrection, he has also conquered death itself. Faith in Christ doesn't just mean our sins are forgiven, as great of a labor and a sacrifice that was for our Savior at Calvary, but it also means that by believing, there's life beyond the grave. There's life beyond this world. That the grave is not the end for us who believe. If Jesus has been resurrected, if he is alive, and he is, we too are who are in Christ, who believe in him, trust in him, will also live. Flip over to John chapter 14 real quick. John chapter 14, Jesus says to us in verse 19, he says, yet a little while and the world will see me no more, but you will see me, because I live, you also will live. John gives us these accounts, this evidence, the testimonies of these eyewitnesses, so we can make a choice, so that we can make the right choice, the good choice, to believe, and that by believing we would have life beyond the grave. And as we've discussed so many times before, Jesus has given us an opportunity to choose another destination, to choose a different outcome for each and every one of us. Without Jesus, there's only one destination for us. There's only one outcome. That's the grave. Without Jesus, there's nothing to look forward to except being 6 feet under. And that's why this world, apart from Jesus, this world is trying so hard to stop it. It's trying so hard to slow it down, to push it back, to push it off as long as possible, trying to overcome death. But there's only one who has done it. There's only one who has conquered death, and there is life, that there's life beyond this grave, and his name is Jesus. And only in him is it possible for us to live beyond that grave. Because God sent us his Son, who lived and died and rose again. And as we'll see today, Jesus has provided us that opportunity to overcome death, to have life in his name. But it is, as Ripley would say, it's up to us to believe it or not. It's up to us to choose. We have to make that choice. No one can make that choice for us. And yes, this event seems unbelievable. It can seem a little weird or far-fetched, even a little spooky. But we don't follow blindly. We believe in Christ. We don't believe in Christ haphazardly. No, we believe because we have proof. We have the evidence. We have the testimonies. We also have an empty tomb. So look with me in verse 1 again of John chapter 20. It says, "Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, 'They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him.'" It was Sunday. It was the first day of the week. It was Easter. But it was the first day of the week, which is why many churches will follow that same pattern of having church on Sunday. It's okay to do that. It's also okay to do another day. But here, this is kind of where this started from. Sundays. This is where Sundays came from, because of Easter. But here we have Mary Magdalene coming early in the morning to the tomb that the body of Jesus was laid in. And we know at least three others came with Mary that morning from the other gospel accounts. And unfortunately, but not surprising, they came not hoping to find the tomb empty, but they came with the hoping to find the body of Jesus still in the tomb. Still there. And we know these women came expecting to find the lifeless body of the Lord so they can complete the burial work that began with Joseph of Arimathea, and Nicodemus. But that's not what they find, is it? That's not what they find. The stone that rested in front of the entrance to the tomb had been rolled away or been taken away, and Mary believes someone has taken the body. Matthew's gospel tells us that there were Roman soldiers guarding the tomb as well, so no one would be able to steal the body of Jesus. But still she runs back to Peter and John, our gospel writer, and says to them that someone has taken the body of Jesus. They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where he is. Jesus is missing. He's MIA, right? The tomb was empty. And upon hearing the news, John and Peter take off. They go running. Look at verse 3. "So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going toward the tomb. Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying there, and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lined with the linen cloths, but folded up in the place by itself. Unfortunately, but not surprisingly, the disciples too were expecting the body of Jesus to still be in that tomb. So when they heard that Mary said his body was missing, they took off running." Okay. They were shocked. They were shocked, and they ran hard. And apparently John wants us to know that he was faster than Peter. Okay. I don't know why that's relevant, but Peter was a little bit slower. But they reached the tomb, and these men wanted to see the tomb for themselves. They wanted to know for sure that the body of Jesus was missing. And John sees it empty from the outside looking in. Peter is a little bit more bold. He goes into the tomb, and he takes a look. And he sees the linen cloths lying there where the body was laid. The linen cloths left behind, and the face cloth that covered Jesus' head was folded up in a place by itself. When the Lord's body was prepared for burial, those strips of linen were smeared with ointments and aloes and spices, and they were applied in several layers. The mixture of the ointments and aloes and spices would dry and harden the cloths, making something similar to like a mummy or a cocoon. And so the normal removal of the burial wrappings would require tearing or cutting. Okay. We could see this from when Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. Flip over to John chapter 11. So Jesus just commanded Lazarus to come out of the tomb. Verse 44 says, "The man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips, and his face wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. Remember, he was dead for 4 days. Okay? But he needed help to be unwrapped. We don't see that here with the cloths left behind from Jesus. Right? Lazarus had to be unbound. Peter saw that it was no normal removal of the burial wrappings. The grave clothes did not look as if they had been put off or taken off. They were lying there in regular folds as if the body of Jesus had just simply evaporated out of them. So how do we approach that? How do we approach this event? What are we to make of these eyewitness accounts of the tomb? Look at verse 8, back in John chapter 20. It says, then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, again, John's boasting a little bit there, also went in and he saw, and what does your Bible say? He believed. Right? Remember why the stone was removed in the first place. Remember why the stone was taken away. It wasn't so Jesus could get out. It was so we could go in. Okay? It was so we could get in, so we could see, so we could know, and so we could believe. Jesus didn't need the stone moved to get out. He needed it moved so we could get in, so we have the proof that he's alive, that he's been resurrected. I love how John writes it here for himself. John entered the tomb, he saw and he believed. Not that John didn't believe who Jesus was before. This word believe here means understand or perceive the significance of this event. In other words, John understood what took place there in that tomb on that first day of the week, on that Easter Sunday. Jesus, or John believed. Jesus was resurrected. Jesus was alive. And there's no other explanation, right? Some would say the Lord was still alive and buried, but the linen cloths would prove that claim to be false, right? There would be shards or tears, things like that in the cloth. Some say his body was stolen, but we know the Roman soldiers were guarding that tomb. Yeah. Even the disciples did not take the body, as some would suggest, because they didn't fully understand this event. Okay, look at verse 9. It says, for as of yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. And the disciples went back to their homes. John includes that statement here in his writing to let us and the readers know that the disciples would not have taken the body of Jesus because they did not understand what it meant for Jesus to rise from the dead. They didn't get that. All John knew was that Jesus is alive, but he didn't know what that truly meant. So they wouldn't take the body. They had no reason to take the body to prove their claims true. Right? They did not understand the meaning of the resurrection yet, so there would be no point for Jesus' followers to take the body themselves. But praise God, we do now understand. Praise God, we now know what it means. Right? Praise God that he sent his son Jesus. He lived and he died and now he rose again, conquering sin, and now he has conquered death. So that we can have life in his name. We praise God for that. So we have the empty tomb. We also have a woman's eyewitness account and her testimony. Look at verse 11. It says, but Mary stood weeping outside the tomb, and as she wept, she stooped to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting there where the body of Jesus had been laid, and one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, woman, why are you weeping? She said to them, they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him. Verse 14, having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking? Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus said to her, Mary. She turned around and said in Aramaic, Rabboni, which means teacher. Verse 17, Jesus said to her, do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and that he had said these things to her. All right, I kind of feel bad for Mary here. Right, you can just tell her heart is utterly broken. Right, she's stricken with grief and sorrow, kind of twice, right? Her Lord died on the cross, now his body is missing. Right, she's kind of got hit twice with the loss of her Lord. Right, and so with the Lord's body missing, she doesn't fully understand that he's alive. She came wanting to have a few final moments with Jesus, finishing the work of his burial, maybe even saying one last goodbye to him before that tomb was sealed permanently. But she didn't have that chance. And so she wept. And she wept in unbelief. Still thinking, still believing Jesus was dead. And it's causing her to miss the evidence of the tomb. It's causing her to miss the evidence. And it's causing her to miss the two angels sitting inside the tomb. One at the head, one at the feet, where the Lord's body was laid. And they're asking her, "Woman, why do you weep?" It's also causing her to miss her Savior, comfortably and compassionately asking her, "Woman, why do you weep?" Her unbelief causes her to think that Jesus is just the gardener tending to the area. Sometimes, the only thing that will hold us back from getting in our way of understanding the truth is unbelief. Okay? It's unbelief, right? That's what unbelief will do. It will cause us to miss the truth, cause us to miss the evidence, cause us to miss what's really going on, and that the Lord is still speaking to us. Hard and difficult times will do that to us too. Times of grief, times of sorrow will have us doubt or question what is really going on. Have us question if God is still there, if he's still speaking to me, if he's still close to me, because it feels like he's many, many miles away. But here we see that God is close. Here we see that God is listening and God is still speaking to us, to her, through the grief and through the sorrow, through the pain and through the hurt, and even through the unbelief. Sometimes, just calling us by name to get our attention. If you notice, Jesus didn't try to get her to understand who he is or convince her of his identity. He's not saying, "Mary, it's me, it's Jesus. Look at my hands, look at my scars, look at that, look at this," right? He's not saying that. What does he do? He says, "Mary." He says, "Mary." Right? And she turns around and says, "Rabboni, teacher." She recognized Jesus when he said her name. It is the good shepherd calling his own sheep. Calling her by name. Okay? And so she recognizes the Lord and she's so excited. She hugs him and clings to him. Probably also because there's a little bit of fear that he might leave again. But Jesus gently tells her to let go, right? She's kind of like a stage 5 cleaner. "You gotta let me go." Okay, but not that Jesus would be defiled from her touching him, but that he could not be detained for too long, right? He's ascending back to the Father. His mention of his ascension signifies that he would only be around for a little while. And that his brethren need to know that Jesus is alive. And so Mary went. Mary went and announced to the disciples all she had seen the Lord, that she had seen the Lord and what he said to her. It's quite a different difference than the first time Mary made it to the disciples. Right? Quite a difference the first time she ran to Peter and John and found the tomb empty. What a great transformation. What a great transformation that took place in her and how excited she was to share it. The same kind of transformation that takes place in us when we believe. When we understand that death is not the end for those who are in Christ. Mary's testimony also argues for the historic truth of this account. If someone fabricated a story, they would certainly not make the first witness to be a woman. Right? They certainly would not make the first witness to be a woman to the resurrection because they were commonly regarded as unreliable witnesses. women were lower class. And here we have Jesus giving Mary the charge of first witness. That's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. And she's sharing the good news that Jesus is alive. That's powerful. But Mary's account is not going to be the only one we have. Look at verse 19 of John's Gospel. It says, on the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, peace be with you. When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. On that same Easter Sunday, that night, all the disciples were gathered together, being locked behind locked doors for fear of the Jews. The disciples were afraid that what happened to Jesus would happen to them. So they hid, and they remained locked behind those closed doors together. But then all of a sudden, John tells us that Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you, right? You're just standing around, all of a sudden, poof, there's Jesus. Right? And he says what? He says, peace be with you. The peace was to quiet their hearts, right? Because they feared the Jews. Peace because Jesus scared them to death by appearing out of nowhere, okay? But more importantly, peace because they have been reconciled to God. They have been reconciled to God. No longer enemies with each other, but now restored. And he has the scars to prove it. Jesus shows the disciples his hands and his side, proving it was really Jesus, proving it was really him. That he really wasn't a ghost or an apparition, but assuring them he was actually the Christ and that he was really raised from the dead. And providing us, all who put our faith in Jesus, the proof that sins have been paid for. Sins have been paid for. Jesus' body on the cross was payment for those sins, and his resurrected body was the receipt for that transaction. It was the receipt for that perfect payment that he made for us in the sight of God. And we have the eyewitnesses to prove it. We have their accounts. Excuse me. We also have their testimony. We have their testimony. But what's even more exciting than that, more amazing, is that Jesus wants his followers to share it. Jesus wants his disciples to share the good news. And not just to the surrounding area, but to the whole world. Why? So that others can believe. They had a mission. And guess what? So do we. Okay. We have that same mission. Look at verse 21. Jesus said to them again, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you. And when he said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld. Jesus previously stated this commission during his prayer to the Father back in the Garden of Gethsemane, before his arrest. And he's speaking it again here to them directly. That these disciples would be sent out. This was the Lord's commission. Go and share. To continue the work he began and model it after the same pattern of the Father sending his Son. To carry the good news forth that God has sent his Son to us who lived, who died, and is alive again. So that many more would have the opportunity to place their hope and their trust in Jesus and have their sins forgiven. Right? We're here today because of these events. Because Jesus is alive and it was shared with us. I know for me, it was shared with me a long time ago. And maybe for you too. Somebody, a friend or a family member, shared the good news of Christ. And we are here today because of these events. So Jesus breathes on them and he says, receive the Holy Spirit. Now we know from the book of Acts that the Holy Spirit won't come until after Jesus is ascended. So what's going on here is Jesus is pledging, it's a pledge on Christ's part that the Holy Spirit would be coming. the pledge that the Holy Spirit would be coming to help them carry out the work which the Lord has called them to do, and to boldly declare the certainty of a sinner's forgiveness by the Father because of the works of His Son, right? Doesn't mean that we have the power to forgive sins. Okay? I can't do that. And I hope you realize you can't do that either. Okay? That's reserved for God and God only. Okay? Doesn't mean we have the power to forgive sins or withhold forgiveness. Only God can do that. But Jesus is telling His disciples, His church, that they have the authority in Jesus' name to declare that sin is forgiven for those who desire repentance, for those who give their lives to Jesus, for those who believe. Okay. And it also means the church has the authority to declare that sins are not forgiven, that sins have not been paid for when people don't put their trust, put their life in Christ. And this account, these eyewitnesses, and all this evidence, that empty tomb, for some, they still remain skeptical. For some, they still don't believe it. They may doubt. Some desire some more hard evidence, like our friend Thomas. And she's more so known doubting Thomas, right? Look at verse 24. It says, "Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, 'We have seen the Lord.' But he said to them, 'Unless I see his hands, the mark of the nails, and place my finger in the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe.' 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, 'Peace be with you.' And then he said to Thomas, 'Put your finger here in my and see my hands, and put your hand and place it in my side. Do not believe, do not disbelieve, but believe.'" Okay. For whatever reason, Thomas was not with the disciples at the Lord's first appearing. And despite their eyewitness account, Thomas still wasn't sold. He wasn't buying it. Possibly thinking that they saw a ghost, right? Which is why Thomas wants to put his fingers in his hands, put his hand in his side. Until then, Thomas says, "I will never believe." It's quite a statement. But 8 days later, Thomas got his wish. The Lord appeared again on Sunday in a room that was locked. And what does Jesus say? "Peace be with you," right? Sorry, I just scared you, so peace. "Peace be with you." And he speaks directly to Thomas. "Put your finger here in my hand. Put your hand in my side," proving to this doubter that Jesus was alive in bodily form and not a ghost. And he has the wounds to prove it. Jesus tells Thomas, "Don't disbelieve, but believe. Trust in me," Jesus is saying. "Trust in me." And I love the response from Thomas. He says, "My Lord and my God." Look at verse 28. Thomas answered him and said, "My Lord and my God." This is the greatest confession a person can make. Thomas acknowledges the role of Jesus in his life. He surrendered himself to Christ as Lord. "You are Lord over my life." And he acknowledges the deity of Jesus, that he truly is God, that he is the Son of God, and the only one who could forgive sins and conquer death. Thomas responds this way because he now believes. The same response is for all who put their faith, their trust in Jesus. And Thomas was honest enough to say when he didn't believe, but he was even more honest to follow the evidence to its full meaning. Thomas saw the evidence and he believed. That Jesus did live, that he did die on a cross, paying for our sin. That Jesus did rise again on that third day, conquering death. And for many in this world, they will like that hard evidence. They will never believe until they see Jesus and his hands and his sides. And if his side, if we wait for that, if people wait that long, it's going to be too late. But technically, that isn't possible for us today, is it? Right? For the Lord has already ascended. back to the Father, seated at his right hand. Thomas believed because he saw his Lord, but what about the rest of us? What about the rest of us? What about all those people after Pentecost? Jesus says we will be blessed. Look at verse 29. So Jesus said to him, Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Blessed, Jesus says. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Jesus foresaw the time when such tangible evidence that Thomas received would not be available, and we would not have the benefit of seeing the resurrected Lord. And for those who will not see, blessed are they. He's talking to you. You guys are blessed. He's talking to me. For those who venture out and take this unique step of faith, for those who believe without seeing, who blessed are they, and blessed are you. We are at no less of an advantage than those first followers. We're not missing out, church, because we're still going to obtain the outcome of our faith. What is that? The salvation of our souls. It doesn't matter if we laid physical eyes on the resurrected Lord. What matters is if we believe. We walk by faith, church. We don't walk by sight. We don't walk by sight. It's by faith. Faith is what matters. Faith in Jesus Christ. Believing that he lived, that he died, and as we've seen today, rising again. Believing in him. And the testimonies and the eyewitnesses, these accounts, the evidence given, that is what matters most. And that's what John wants us to understand. Look at verse 30. It says, now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. I love that. These things are written so that you may believe. Ripley didn't care a whole lot if you believed in the stories or strange events. He really didn't care if you thought them true or not. He didn't care if you doubted or found them to be false or unbelievable. But John does. John does. Because that was his heart for all who would read his gospel. That's his heart for us as we go through this gospel. But even more than John, I know God does too. Because he's the one who made it all possible, and he desires a different outcome for us and for you. A destination other than the grave. That is why we still have his word, church. And I'm so grateful for that. That's why we have his word with us. And gosh, how we don't use it. We don't have time in it. Right? These things are written so that we would believe. But oftentimes it gets shoved to the side. There was no eternal consequence for the people who didn't believe the stories from Ripley. There is, however, an eternal consequence for those who don't believe in the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus. Right? God came to save us from that consequence. And all we need to do is believe. And that by believing, we would have life in his name. Flip over to John chapter 11 real quick. We'll close with this. Jesus is going to leave us with a question. Verse 25. So Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. And here's the question. Do you believe this? Do you believe this? Is your life founded on this? Let's pray. Father God, again, we just thank you for this time in your word. And we thank you for the testimonies, eyewitness accounts. We thank you for that empty tomb and what it means for us that, Jesus, you are alive. And that when we put our faith in you, we have life. But the grave's not the end for us. It's just a transition point. Our home is with you. We're not buried in the earth. So I pray, God, I pray that we would be more intent, more sincere about our relationship with you, about our reading of your word, and about our faith. Do we believe this? Yes. Lord, we just thank you for all that you've done for us. That you have paid for our sins, and that you have given us life. So, Lord, help us to be that church, that new creation that you breathed on the disciples to go out and spread the good news. Help us to go out and spread the good news. That's what we do. That's what the main mission of the church is, to go out and share the gospel. That's our mission. I pray that's our heart. And I pray it stems from faith in you, Jesus. So thank you for this time. May you watch over us this week. Help us to work off all that tricky. And enjoy the week and be blessed, Lord. Help us to remember that we are blessed because we have you. And that we walk by faith. Help us to remember that we are blessed. And that's in your great name, Jesus, we pray. Everyone said, amen. All right, let's worship.